Welcome to this edition of History and Highballs as part of the North Carolina Museum of History's celebration of Women's History Month. We're so glad that you're joining us for this evening's program, History and Highballs, Women Who Brew. My name is Stacy, and I handle adult education over at the museum. So whenever you sign up to join us for one of these History and Highballs programs, you and I will virtually get to spend the evening together listening to some incredible stories about North Carolina places and people and what makes our state so amazing. Tonight's program is just one of many exciting virtual offerings available through MOH. So if you'd like to learn more about our History at Home initiative, head on over to the museum's website at www.ncmuseumofhistory.org. That's also where you can find information about shopping at our wonderful museum shop, as well as joining our North Carolina Museum of History Associates. Our associates and foundation provide crucial funding and support to the museum, which, in addition to many other things, helps make programming like this evening's program possible. We would like to thank all of those of you who graciously donated funds towards this evening's program. We do our best to keep our programs free to attend, but there are costs associated with keeping our series going, and we just continue to be so appreciative of your support of the museum and its programs. A few quick housekeeping items for this evening. We ask that you please keep your mics muted throughout the entirety of the event, and that if you have any questions for our speaker, to please type them into the chat function located at the bottom center of your screen. At the end of the program, our intern Simone will ask our speakers as many of your questions as time allows. So it's my honor to introduce this evening's speaker, Michelle Miniutti, who along with Jackie Hudspeth and Ellen Joyner are the founders of Bombshell Beer Company in Holly Springs, North Carolina. Michelle and Ellen were business colleagues who also like to visit breweries and craft-centric beer bars. So it seemed natural when, in January of 2011, after a day of visiting local breweries, Michelle suggested to Ellen, who had actually been a home brewer for more than 10 years, that they start their own microbrewery. Both had strong business management backgrounds and entrepreneurial spirits, so they formed a plan, asked Jackie to join their venture, and got to work. At that time, the U.S. had only 3 100% woman-owned microbreweries. But within 5 years, Bombshell Beer Company had changed that, and its beers had won more than 25 medals in international, national, and regional competitions. In March 2020, the company was named one of the 10 most amazing women-led breweries and distilleries in the world by 10 Best, a division of USA Today. Okay, so I'm going to turn it over to you. Welcome. Thanks so much for being here with us.
Thank you so much. Good evening. So joining me today is Kat Pierce, who is one of my sales reps working for Bombshell. And she's also the chapter president of the Pink Boot Society, which is an organization that helps women in the fermentation industries. And we'll talk a little bit about Pink Boots towards the end of the presentation this evening. All right, so let's just go to the first, and here's Ellen. All right, so we thought we'd start out with a little bit of trivia this evening. And how many breweries are in North Carolina? So we'll give you a couple of seconds here to think about what your answer might be. And the answer is C. 320 breweries. Now, pre-COVID, it might have been, if I had made the slide up, the next day it probably would have been 321. But with the onset of COVID, the opening of breweries has slowed down a little bit. All right, next slide. So most of you may already know how beer is made, but we thought we'd give just a very high-level cursory view of how beer is made and a few other factors around it. Beer is made of four main ingredients: water, hops, barley, and yeast. And we combine those ingredients at different phases of the brewing process to get the different types of end results that you're looking for as a consumer. It's one of the world's most popular alcoholic drinks. And, you know, the tastes range from sweet to bitter to roasty. And one thing that most people don't understand about beer is that beer actually complements food more than wine does. Beer can give the umami flavor a better complement than wine can in general. So that's just a little fun fact for y'all to know. Historically, beer has been classified into two segments, ales and lagers. And that is primarily a result of how the beer is fermented. Ales tend to have yeast that is fermenting on the top. Lagers tend to have fermentation of yeast that is kind of conducted throughout the entire fermentation vessel. Lagers are also conditioned more. Ales take about 2 weeks to make. Lagers take usually anywhere from 5 weeks or longer, depending on what the outcome and the particular style of lager is that you're making. You can see just the differences in alcohol by volume. And then one good thing that people should know when you're pouring your beer is that you actually want to pour it at an angle, and that's a little infographic. One of the things that's really important to do when you are drinking a craft beer is to make sure that you pour some foam on the top. And what that's going to do is really let the aroma of the beer kind of pervade the experience and create, you know, more sensory awareness about what you're going to taste and enjoy. So the key steps with the brewing process are hot water. You add the grain to the hot water, then you put it, that's put into what we call the mash tun. The mash tun basically forms kind of like, almost like a porridge, where the grain that has been wet becomes thick in consistency, and then the liquid that's surrounding it becomes sweet. And that's what we call wort. We then take that wort and we transfer over to the brew kettle. We boil the wort for a particular period of time, depending on what style of beer or particular measurements we're trying to get. Then during the boil, we can add hops, which we normally do. And that will give the beer bitterness, some additional flavors. We can also infuse hops through something called a hop back. Once we've done that, then we cool the wort down before we transfer over to a fermentation vessel. And at the fermentation vessel, we add yeast, and then the fermentation process begins. And as I mentioned before, in the overall fermentation process normally takes about 2 weeks. And then if it's a lager, there's some additional steps that transpire. So that's just kind of a very high level overview of the brewing process. There's actually a lot of chemistry that's involved, I've given you a very simplified overview of it. Ellen, I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
No, you did a great job.
All right. Thumbs up for my business partner. All right. Next slide. So here's some statistics about the brewing industry, and it's going to be really interesting once everything from 2020 is finally compiled. Unfortunately, those numbers will have taken a downturn. But you can just look at this. I mean, I think the big thing is that there's been a significant amount of growth in the craft beer industry. And it is a lot of small breweries and brew pubs such as Bombshell that are really helping to contribute to a lot of that growth. We're still fighting for share in the beer market against, you know, the big boys, the Bud Lights, the Budweisers of the world. They still have the lion's share of the market share, and you know, we've made inroads in that. I think when we started in 2010, the micro share was about 5%. So it's grown significantly up to 13.6% in 2019. All right. Next slide. So one of the things that I think it's important to know is, what is a craft brewery? So a craft brewery by the Brewers Association is defined as a brewer that produces 6 million barrels of beer or less. And They also have to be independent, which means that an entity cannot own more than 25% of them if they're a larger producer. So, you know, you may have heard of some of the acquisitions that have occurred in the state of North Carolina, and I'll use Wicked Weed as an example. Wicked Weed was an independent microbrewery, but now they are owned by AB InBev. And because of that, they're technically not classified as a craft brewery. So you have a lot of choices as a consumer when you're going out there. Wicked Weed makes great beer. But, you know, as a small independent brewery owner, I would ask that, you know, you look for this little symbol that is on the side of the slide. And that denotes that that if you're buying the beer, it's coming from a small independent craft brewery. All right, next slide. So let's have another little trivia question. Which woman goddess was the first to brew beer in 1800 BC? All right, and the answer to that is B, Ninkazi. So she is known as the founder of modern, not so much modern, but beer as we know it today. And she instructed many other females, priestesses, to brew beer, and beer got its footing in the area of Mesopotamia. All right, next slide. All right, so this is just, again, just a little overview of our brewery. And Stacy was stated our overview so well. We do have a tap room, and our production brew facility is located at Quantum Street in Holly Springs. And we are, again, an independent craft brewery. And we were North Carolina's first 100% women-owned microbrewery. And as I know it, we are still the only 100% women-owned microbrewery. There are a number that are majority-owned that are in the state of North Carolina, but to the best of my knowledge, we are still the only 100% women-owned microbrewery. Next slide. So we established in 2012. Statistically, we were the 11th brewery in Wake County, and now I think there's close to 50. So the landscape has certainly changed. In our first year of production, we did about 780 barrels, and in 2019, we did about 2,400 barrels. That's a statistic that you will hear used often in the brewing industry. I thought I'd take just a minute to kind of explain what a barrel of beer is. A barrel of beer is 31 gallons. And up on the right-hand side, you can see two kegs. So what normally everybody says is a keg of beer is like the larger one, the 15.5 gallon keg that's on the left here. So it's two half barrels that make up a barrel of beer. There you go, two half barrels. Now you're following. And then the 5.16 gallon keg is a sixtel. And there are six sixtels in a barrel. So math is pretty easy there, but I thought I'd just take a moment to explain that. We also are a self-distributing brewery. And what that means is that we sell all of our beer directly to bars, restaurants, grocery stores, and different retail venues that buy our beer. And we have 13 amazing employees and three owners that help us to get our beer to the market. All right, next slide. So, what city in North Carolina has the most breweries? And the answer to that is B, Asheville. Asheville has a little over, I believe, 100 breweries. So they definitely have the lion's share of breweries around the state. All right, next slide. So what is a bombshell? And one of the things that we had hoped to show you is a little bit of a film that we had that kind of explained where the name Bombshell came from. So when we first got into the industry, we were kind of shocked that there were so few women that were involved in the brewing industry. That has since changed, and we're very happy about that. But we like the definition of bombshell, which is something that's shocking, unexpected, and surprising. So that's kind of where our name came from. We were like, hey, we're starting a microbrewery, and we're a woman-owned microbrewery, and that's shocking and unexpected. So that's where the word bombshell came from. All right, next slide. So this is actually a slide that I stole from Ellen when she had done a presentation talking about life as an entrepreneur. And you're jack of all trades. You don't ever set an alarm clock because you never start or stop working. And you get to wear jeans, shorts, sneakers, t-shirts every day. Now, of course, with COVID, now everybody wears yoga pants. So that's not really such a privilege anymore. But we do, many of us were in corporate America where, you know, we had to either wear business casual or business. So this is definitely a treat to be able to come to work more casual. We work all the days at N and Y, and people often ask, like, all right, well, what's really different from working in corporate America versus working in your own business? Well, I still get to work 80 hours a week. I just pick which 80 hours I want to work. And then the other thing we always hear is, oh, it really must be nice to drink free beer. Well, it's not free. It's $1 million beer. Owning and operating a brewery costs a lot of money. And this is the most expensive beer I've ever drank and probably will ever drink. All right, next slide. So one of our popular beers that we are producing right now is our Wild Juice Hazy IPA. And hazy IPAs are definitely one of the most prolific styles of beer right now. You love them or you hate them, but they are definitely out there. And our Wild Juice Hazy IPA is really a delicious beer. It has a wonderful mouthfeel. We use lactose in there to give it that nice soft mouthfeel. And it has a lot of bright citrus notes. So look for Wild Juice Chase if you want to try a really nice and new hazy IPA. All right, next slide. So these are just some fun pictures. Our production facility is about 5,800 square feet. It used to formally serve as a distribution center for the News and Observer, and then it was a hiring center for Walmart before we took it over. We had to do a lot of stuff to the building, and here are some of the pictures of us tearing up the concrete to put drainage systems in. And then also one of the things that people ask us when they come to our tap room is, why do you have a wall between our production space and the tap room? And there is an ordinance in the town of Holly Springs that stipulates that a manufacturing environment must be separated by a 1-hour firewall from any type of retail environment. Therefore, that's why we have a wall there. So it wasn't our first choice. It's always nice to go to a brewery where you can kind of see and be close and feel, you know, really look at the tanks, but it just wasn't an option for us. There's some pictures here of us uprighting our equipment. When we first started, we had 3 fermenters. We had 2 15 barrel tanks and 1 30 barrel tank. And we now have 9 fermentation vessels. Ellen, is that right? Whoops, Ellen pressed, there we go. There she goes, she's off mute now.
There's 8 fermentation vessels and 1 bright tank.
All right, so significantly more capacity. And as I mentioned, we did about 2,400 barrels, and on a theoretical basis, we could brew about 3,400 barrels of beer in our current space. If we were working on kind of a double brew schedule each day and moving beer through the brewery about 7 days a week. we have a nice outdoor patio area. And with COVID, we've put some tents up so people can social distance appropriately, but yet take advantage of some of the nice fresh air, but have heaters and all of the like. So a nice warm and inviting area. All right, next slide. We really pride Bombshell on being a place of fun. These are just some pictures pre-COVID of different things that we like to do. We pride ourselves as being a community spot. We've done gingerbread house making, we've had Easter egg hunts, we have a doggy Halloween costume party, we have Halloween parties, and we also have a fabulous run club that's affiliated with Pace Yourself Run Club. And the original founders of the run club were Holly Springs Run Club, and there's close to, I believe, 2,000 members in that club. So it's a great, we just really pride ourselves as being a great place for all to come and have fun and be welcomed. Next slide. To that end, we also pride ourselves as being very rooted in the community. Prior to COVID, we were hosting what was called Fundraiser Fridays, and we did those on the first and the third of each month, where we gave 10 to 15% of beer sales to a charitable entity or a community cause during the evening hours. We also enable those charities or causes to have, you know, a raffle or other types of fundraising activity on premise while we're conducting the event. And, you know, we were really proud in 2019 to have those charities raise more than $20,000 combined with what we've given them and what they were able to raise on premise through other activities. So, you know, I think that's the other thing too, when you look at small craft, independent craft brewers, is what they're doing for the community and what they're giving back. And then in 2020, of course, we were limited to what we could do, but we found a way to do a frontline worker give back. We were approached by another local business that said that they wanted to make an anonymous donation of a certain amount of cash. And then we met that, we matched that particular amount of cash plus some, and we enabled frontline workers to register, and they could come in and choose either a 6 or a 4 pack of choice when COVID was in its big throes during last March to last June. So just some things that, you know, we constantly try to be connected with the community. Next slide. One thing that we're certainly very proud of, Stacy mentioned earlier that we were recognized as one of the 10 most amazing breweries and distilleries that are women-led in the world. That was really a big thrill. Unfortunately, we made that headline on March 4th. And as we all know, there was a lot of other big news that was going on. So we really would have liked to have had more fanfare around this piece of recognition. But it's still something that we cherish, and we feel very, very honored to be named to the list among a bunch of other wonderful distilleries and breweries that are women-led. All right, next slide. In addition, one of our really big medals that we won was a 2019 GABF bronze medal in the barrel aged beer category for our bourbon barrel aged Lady in Red. And the Great American Beer Festival competition is the largest national competition. About 2,300 breweries entered, and there were over 9,300 beers that were judged in over 107 categories. And we were the only Triangle Area Brewery in 2019 to win a medal. And we were one of 12 medals for all of North Carolina. So we were very, very happy with this award. Next slide. This is just kind of an overview of the other medals that we've won. So we have a great production team that's doing some great things. All right, next slide. So at the beginning, we talked about the Pink Boot Society, and Kat is the chapter leader president. And Pink Boots was created by Terry Farrandoff to assist, inspire, and encourage women in the fermented and alcoholic beverage professionals through education, networking, and professional development. I was looking at the slide and something got cut off. So one of the big things that the Pink Boot Society does is they have a collaborative brew day. And that collaborative brew day is normally conducted in and around International Women's Day, which is on March 8th. And this year on March 8th, it fell on a Monday. So it was conducive to us having a collaborative brew on International Women's Day, which was really exciting. So we had a bunch of awesome people, a lot of ladies from the Pink Boot Society and a number of other people that came and brewed a fabulous hazy IPA by our assistant brewer, Taylor Spoon. She formulated the recipe and we got a great result that's coming out. The kegs will be hitting the market this week, and then packaged beer should be out, not this coming week, but the following week. And we historically have donated a portion of the sales from the Pink Boots beer back to the Pink Boots Society for scholarship purposes. Pat, I don't know if you have anything that you would like to add to that.
Yeah, so I mean, Pink Boots, one of the things that we do a lot specifically for education for females in the fermented beverage industry, but one of those things that we do is we actually create scholarships, and these scholarships have multiple opportunities that range from different portions of the careers that people can hold in industry. So for me, I was a recipient in 2019 to go to the North Carolina Craft Brewers Conference. We have another chapter member at the RDU section that has received a scholarship to attend UNC Charlotte for a craft beer business program. We have sent people to Germany to study. We've sent people to the Brewing Institute. So, you know, there have been a lot of opportunities where we've helped further women's careers in industry via the scholarships and the professional development that we provide. And it's 100% nonprofit.
It for our slides. So Stacy, I think we can move on to Q&A if people have some questions. We'd be happy to engage with that.
Thank you guys. So our intern Simone is going to be asking you questions from the chat from our audience.
All right.
So Simone, whenever you're ready.
All right. So Travis asked, he said several years ago, Bombshell had an awesome lighter or wheat beer called Star or something like that. The beer went away, but now Highland has a beer called Stargazer. Do breweries trade or sell recipes to each other, or have trouble getting the specific ingredients for a beer when it's a hit and demand increases?
That's a great question. Ellen, do you want to answer that, or you want me to answer it, or?
Oh, I'll answer it, yeah. Okay. So the beer was Starlight, and it was a cream ale. And what we find, like with any type of product, they ride the growth curve, and then they start to slide, and sales start to slack off, and it's time to boot it and come up with something new. As far as Highland, you know, no, we don't sell each other's recipes, and we don't trade recipes. We do have a really great network and friendship with all the other breweries around. And so when we're short something because a supplier didn't ship us something or it didn't get there on time, we can pick up the phone and call another brewery in town and ask them if they have it. And it's usually You're going to find it, and people are very willing to loan you or sell you ingredients that you don't happen to have on hand if you get caught in a bind.
So one thing I will add, Travis, if you liked the Starlight Ale, we actually have a new beer that we're bringing into the portfolio called Laid Back Ale. Well, that's been the prototype. We have a new proposed name for this beer as it's been in development that's currently in front of the North Carolina ABC Commission. Once that name is approved, then we are going to release the beer. But I'm drinking it I don't know if you can see it here. I'll have to put it in front of me like this. We're using a virtual background. but it's very light. It's very easy drinking. It's kind of like a light American lager style. So be on the lookout for that. You'll definitely be able to get it in the tap room, probably in about a month in packaged product, month and a half, as far as cans are concerned, but we do have it on draft right now. We're going to make a couple of tweaks to the recipe before we go out with the final recipe version. But I think the people that enjoyed Starlight, this is right up your alley. All right, next question.
All right, Jennifer asked, what is IBU?
Great question. So IBUs stands for International Bittering Units, and it's a measurement of how bitter a beer is. So when you look at an IPA, normally you will see that IBU range kind of starting in and around 45, and then going upwards. Now, about 5 years ago, when West Coast style IPAs were really popular, like the bigger the number, the better. You know, Stone had an IPA that was 120 IBUs. And there's kind of a thought process out there that there's kind of a flattening of the curve in terms of perceived bitterness. So once you get out to about 80 or 90 IBUs, it's really hard to discern any measurable degree of additional bitterness. But let's just put it at this. Anything above 80 is bitter. Next question.
All right. Do you guys know when North Carolina first allowed craft breweries?
So North Carolina used to have a limit on malt beverage production of alcoholic beverages that were, you could only do something under 5%. And there was a movement that was initiated that was called Pop the Cap. And when Pop the Cap actually came to fruition, they popped the cap, and breweries were able to now brew fermented beverages that were above 5%. That's kind of when most of the craft breweries kind of started to take foothold here in North Carolina. And that year was 1998, I believe.
All right. Kirsten asked, why has it taken so long for women to get involved in the brewing business? Has your opinion about this changed from when you started in 2012, or do you think that women tend not to be entrepreneurs of non-cottage industries?
There's a lot of really interesting questions within that question. Kat actually wants to respond to some of that, and then we can, all of us can share in this.
Yeah, so I mean, ultimately, beer brewing was at first historically a woman's job, right? And so women would brew beers at home in the kitchens, and they would teach their kids how to do it. And it was very much like a familial activity to do together. And it was also something that would bring people together like it does today. But unfortunately, at one point in time, when actual industrial breweries started to come up, that was primarily dominated by men. And so at one point in time, they decided that any woman that was brewing beer in her own home was actually stirring the pot, and they started calling them witches. So women who still wanted to follow this tradition, what they would do is they would put a broom at the top of their front door to indicate that they were making homemade beer and it was for sale. But that's where the whole idea of, you know, witches fly on brooms comes from. But, you know, ultimately, in my opinion, I just think it stems immediately from that point in time in which it has just continued to be a male-dominated industry. Now, there's also the stereotype that women don't drink beer, right? There is a lot of commercialization out there that primarily advertises to the male crowd. And then there's this whole idea that, you know, well, it's not an idea, it's true. Brewing beer is hard work. And unfortunately, as a result of that, there has been a stereotype put that women can't brew beer because it's hard labor. And, you know, beyond that, it has just been such a difficult process for women to kind of break through that ceiling to be able to get into it. And even though there are multiple women that have tried, you know, they'll come in and they say, hey, let me come wash kegs for you. Let me bartend for you. Let me do this and try and work their way up the ladder. But a man comes by and unfortunately they have had better opportunities to be able to further their career in the beer industry. So a lot of women eventually just kind of get tired of it and they move on to something else. But I'm sure these ladies will have another idea as well.
That's spot on. It really, you know, women were always the brewers of beer. You know, whether it was in early medieval times where they were brewing and, you know, the men were going off to battle and they were coming back and they'd have, you know, their ale and their grog. And that was all done, you know, in small batches by women. And that's basically what did happen when beer started to be produced on more of a mass scale in factories. Then, you know, the craft of brewing was kind of stolen from women. So, you know, that's definitely come back. There are more women that are involved. It is hard work. I mean, you're lifting 50, 60 pound grains of sacks of grain. You know, a half barrel of beer weighs 160 pounds. But, you know, there is an awareness and definitely more safety standards in the industry that nobody should be lifting 160 pound keg by themselves. I mean, brewers,
whether you're a male or female.
it is notorious that brewers they blow out their backs all the time. So it's not a good safety practice. It's a team lift. So, you know, I think it's working smart, not hard. And, you know, I just don't think it's, you know, there are some times where things are heavy, but, you know, if you open up a sack of grain and you take 10 pounds out, then you can lift it in. But it is physical work, and but that shouldn't, you know, prevent anybody from, you know, being involved in it.
Now, as part of the entrepreneurial portion of it, they did ask about like why you think women are not pursuing the entrepreneurial to open up a brewery.
I think it's just there aren't a lot of mentors right now. You know, and as more women such as myself and Ellen and Kat become involved in the brewing industry, then, you know, we can share our knowledge with more women, and, you know, that will lead to more women, you know, becoming involved in the industry. So I think it's a matter of time. And, you know, just in the short while that, you know, I've been in this business now, I've definitely seen, you know, 2-3-4-fold of increase in women participating at varieties of levels, whether it's in the sales category or the commercial production or the management role. Ellen, I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
I can't hear you.
She's on mute. You're on mute.
Sorry. I think y'all hit it. That was a lengthy question and I see lots coming. So maybe we move on to the next question.
All right. Michelle says she loves hard ciders and she was wondering if you guys brew any.
No, we don't brew any ciders right now. We also don't do any seltzers, although we're looking at doing some seltzers. So unfortunately, no, but we do have cider available in our tap room.
Do you guys get farmers to grow specific types of hops for you?
So we predominantly buy from hop growing groups that are in some different parts of the world, primarily in the U.S. They're up in the Pacific Northwest, in Oregon and Washington. There are also some pretty significant growing groups in Europe, New Zealand, and Australia. Those are kind of where most of the hop growers exist. Hops as an industry are growing in North Carolina, and that's wonderful. You know, we have explored, I think, once or twice with some locally grown hops. And, you know, we hope that we can continue to grow that base as the hop varieties become more predictable and dependable that are coming out of North Carolina.
How many new recipes do you guys try in a year?
Ellen's probably rolling her eyes. Kat and I and a couple of other people kind of head up the sales component of Bombshell. And, you know, one of the things that we're always asked when we go into bottle shops is, what do you have that's new? That is something that is, I don't want to say it's a fault. I think it's a curiosity of craft beer drinkers, is that they're always looking for something new that they haven't tried. And that desire to always have something new in turn kind of permeates down to our production schedule, where we always ask, can we brew something new so that we have something new and exciting to take out into the marketplace? And constantly doing something different really is taxing on our production team. I think we did 36 different beers last year, Ellen. I think that was the number.
I don't know, but it was up there.
Yeah. So, you know, it's a lot. And we're trying to hit, in a lot of different style areas. A lot of those are IPAs, because that's what the market really wants. Not everybody's an IPA drinker, but that is something that is in, you know, a lot of demand.
All right. Are you making bourbon barrel beer a staple for your brewery?
So the answer to that is yes. We're constantly looking at putting beer in bourbon barrels. I think we just put some of this year's Uber Night into Maker's Mark barrels. We've historically used a lot of Buffalo Trace barrels, and we are looking at putting a batch of our Dirty Secret Coconut Stout into some rum barrels. We think that'll be a new twist on things. And we do have, we have some expansion plans that we're trying to put into place right now. And one of those expansion plans has an expansion of a barrel aging program, both in the mixed culture, which would be sour type beer, as well as more wood aged beer, from a spirits perspective.
All right. Do you guys make a Hefeweizen style beer, or have any plans to?
So, as a smaller brewery, one of the things that we must do to keep our beer good is have active yeast use. And in a brewery our size, for the past year, with some of the limitations that we've had with COVID, kind of the number of strains that we can manage appropriately is about 3. Unfortunately, a Hefeweizen yeast, which is normally referred to as a Weinstephan yeast, is not in the mix. So we would like to do that. But those tend to go a little bit better in the summer. So there may be some possibilities of that. Keep a lookout for it. When we do something like that, we usually don't put it into packaged product. We specifically just put it into kegs and, you know, it's available in our tap room.
We do have an American wheat ale. It's just not, it doesn't have the clove and banana phenols and yeast characteristics that a Hefeweizen would.
It is an American wheat. It's delicious.
It's called Hipster Handshake.
Do you all have plans to brew a black IPA?
Man, we've talked about this before. I would love to brew a black IPA. A black IPA happens to be one of my absolute favorite styles. Unfortunately, they just don't sell well out in the market. And this is actually a conversation that the craft beer industry as a whole is talking about. And there are a few folks that do make them, but it typically tends to be their core beer style and they're known for doing it. So they're a little more successful with that particular style. For a brewery like us, it's probably not in the cards unless we do like a small batch of it later on in the future. And hopefully black IPAs will make a comeback. There have been some people saying that it will make a comeback, just like, you know, the traditional West Coast clear IPAs are making a comeback. So hopefully, you know, everybody cross your fingers and cross all your toes and hopefully it'll come back.
All right, Denise asks, what are your light beer options?
So we have, when you say light beer, normally that refers to beers that are lighter in flavor. So our laid back ale that I'm drinking right now, I'm gonna put it where you can see it, is kind of our light option that we have. And then we also have another beer that is a session IPA. If you're looking for something that is light and full, very full flavored, that session IPA has 95 calories and 3 grams of carbs. So if you're looking for something kind of in that, you know, lower carb, lower cal segment, those are the two offerings that we can steer you toward.
All right, Sandra asks, where did you all train? Are you self-taught?
Yes. So, Ellen, why don't you start and then I can.
Yeah, so I'm self-trained, do a lot of reading. I started as a home brewer and with a kit that I'd gotten from my brother for Christmas and brewed the very first batch of beer I brewed. It turned out really fabulous. So it's really a lot of reading that I've done. I've taught Michelle how to homebrew, and that was a lot of fun. And then, you know, you go to craft brewers conferences and you learn a lot, and you learn a lot from talking to other brewers in how to do things. And we're members of a lot of different societies, and there's lots of information out there. As far as going to a brewing school, no, none of us have done that. Although we have had brewers on staff that have attended brewing schools. So we also have learned from our brewers various elements.
Yeah, so Ellen taught when we were thinking about starting the brewery, we really started doing a lot of home brewing, big test batches. And I always joke around, Ellen was the head chef and I was the sous chef. And one of the things that's critical in the beer brewing process is sanitation. And so I had the pleasure of cleaning and sanitizing, and Ellen was a good director and I was, you know, the good person that did a lot of what she told me to do. So yeah, we'd leave, you know, our corporate jobs at 6 o'clock at night, and then we'd come to my house and we would be brewing until 11-12 o'clock at night, usually about 3 to 4 days a week, and then one day on the weekend. So it was a pretty impassioned process for us. And the other thing that a lot of people don't know is homebrewing is actually a really time-intensive process. Believe it or not, it takes about the same amount of time to brew a commercial batch, we have what's called a 15 barrel system. So it's approximately about 432 gallons of beer that we can brew at one time. It takes about the same amount of time to brew 432 gallons on our commercial system as it's going to take a home brewer to brew a 5-gallon batch. By the time you do all your prep, you do sanitation, you do your brew, you clean up. So if you are looking at home brewing, it's very time intensive.
It's fun.
It is fun.
It's a great excuse to sit around and drink beer.
It sounds like so much fun. Do you guys sell your beer anywhere outside of North Carolina, specifically Virginia?
So currently we do not. We only distribute within North Carolina, and we don't really have any plans to go out of state. Every mile that you venture away from the brewery, it becomes more and more difficult to gain brand awareness and a cost-effective distribution platform.
All right, Sandra asked if you guys have a women's beer club.
Ah, that's a great question. So we don't specifically have just a women's beer club. I like that though. That might be a nice new option for the future. But you know, we do try to support Pink Boots. A lot of us will get together. Pink Boots are just friends and, you know, hang around, have a beer, talk about the industry, talk about trends in beer. So
learn
some stuff. And I think the exciting thing about Pink Boots now versus maybe 3 or 4 years ago is it used to be predominantly members that were in sales or in retail serving. And now we have, which, you know, is great, we have a lot more female brewers that are in the Pink Boot Society, which is really awesome because it says that more women are permeating. So yeah, it's awesome.
All right, Nikki asked if you guys make any shandies.
We have in the past made some shandies. And those have been extremely well received. Might be something we look at doing in the summer. It really depends on, you know, how things are going and what our capacity is, because we do have a lot of requests for that lighter style of beverage during the summer.
All right. Kyle asked, what do you wish the federal or state government would do to help you grow your business?
Wow, that's a great.
Lower taxes.
So one of the things that people are not necessarily aware of is we get taxed on our production at the federal level. So it has nothing to do whether or not we're profitable, which we are, but you get taxed from day one on your level of production. So when we were first when we first started out, we got taxed on day one of our beer production. That tax rate has since been lowered, and it was just recently passed that that rate is staying lower. It's what,
350
a barrel of beer produced. And then we are also taxed at the state level. And Ellen, you pay the taxes, so I'll let you speak to it.
Yeah, hey. 0.6171 cents per gallon of beer. So basically it's about $19 for every barrel of beer that we produce. We pay in an excise tax to the state.
So in some instances, tax is our number one cost of production in some of the lower cost beers to produce. So yeah, if they cut taxes, that would help a lot. You know, and like anything else, I mean, you know, regulation is, you know, another problem that, you know, we have. There are, the alcohol industry is highly, highly regulated. And there are a lot of antiquated things that are done in North Carolina that need to be modernized. But like any government type agency, they're short-staffed as well. And they're trying, you know, as best they can. I'll put a wonderful pitch in for the North Carolina Brewers Guild. They've really done a great job at advocating here at North Carolina, and then also working with a lot of the other guilds at the state levels to help affect legislative changes at the national level. So there is definitely that support mechanism that's out there.
All right, we have time for one more question. So Fred asked, do you ever do a honey brew, or would you consider doing a honey brew with local honey?
So I'll answer that. We've made a couple of honey beers. We made one in conjunction with the Frontier Center out in RTP, where they have their own honey nest, or I'm not sure what colonies. They harvest the honey with beekeepers of Raleigh, I believe, in downtown. Anyways, they gave us about 60 pounds of honey, and we made a beer called Swarm Trooper for them. And we sold it in the market. And then we turned around and we've made a couple of other honey beers. So yeah, we probably get one honey beer in a year that we make. And we're certainly always looking for local honey when we can get that. It's just that we need a lot of poundage of that to make.
That's awesome. Well, that's all the questions that I have for you guys. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you all for such a wonderful talk this evening. I certainly have experience drinking craft beer. I don't have an experience making it, but now I'm thinking maybe I'll venture into that and then show up at Bombshell for a decent, lovely beer once mine fails miserably. And thank you all for joining us this evening. We hope that you enjoyed it. And we hope to see you at our next History in Highballs, which will be happening on Thursday, April 8th. It'll be the Halifax Resolves, and that'll be at 7 p.m. Thank you, women of Bombshell Brewing. We are so excited to have you this evening, and we all look forward to coming out and grabbing a beer with you soon.
Thank you. Yeah. Have a great evening.
Thank you.
Cheers.